So what I'll be telling you about today is this about this body of research that has been done by biologists on the evolution of female orgasm among humans. So the female orgasm in humans presents an evolutionary puzzle. The male orgasm in humans does not present an evolutionary puzzle. It's very clear what the function is. It has a very clear evolutionary function. It makes males want to have more sex, which in turn entails more offspring. Right? So that the story there is very simple. There's no problem there. But if on the female side of things, things are not as simple for two reasons. Well, we'll talk about that. One of them is that nearly three quarters, or in any case, a very high percentage of women do not achieve orgasm during intercourse. That's one fact. The other fact is that there is no correlation, no association between increased reproductive success and being able to have orgasms in women. So there's no correlation. So there is a bit of an evolutionary puzzle here. So what I'll be telling you about today is basically taken from this wonderful book called The Case of the Female Orgasm, Bias in the Science of Evolution by Elizabeth Lloyd. And this is the philosopher of biology that I was telling you about. And the good news for all of us is that Elizabeth Lloyd will be coming to Groningen. And on the 21st of May, she'll be delivering a public lecture, a public Aspasia lecture, at the aula of the Academiegebouw. So if you like what I'll be telling you here, this is just kind of the appetizer. And if you like what you're hearing here, go listen to her, because that will be the real thing. I'm just kind of the fake version of the real thing. So before we get to female orgasm in particular, first I want to tell you a couple of things about the key concept, which will really be very important throughout my presentation, namely the concept of adaptation. I'm sure that all of you have heard about this before, right? The concept of adaptation before. But the thing is that even among biologists, there's quite some disagreement as to what exactly an adaptation means. So the one part, I'll highlight two aspects of the concept of adaptation. The first one is not controversial. The first one is the idea that an adaptation is a trait that confers greater fitness and or increased reproductive success to the individuals who possess it. So here you see, I think it's a cricket, but you know, I'm pretty bad at identifying different animals. So if somebody thinks this is not a cricket, I'm happy to be corrected here. But in any case, whatever this animal has a very nice adaptation. Namely, it looks like a leaf. So you can imagine how easy it can escape from predators compared to insects that don't look like leaves. So this is clearly an adaptation. And in such cases, there really is a correlation between having the trait, having this feature, and reproductive success. So there will be more offspring of this kind. The second trait is slightly more controversial among biologists, but it's, I think, still quite widely accepted. It's the idea that for a trait to count as an adaptation in a given species, it has to be widely present in the species. So here you see polar bears, and the vast majority of polar bears are white, and that is, of course, an adaptation in the environment where they live. So it's widely present. It doesn't mean that it has to be 100% every member of the species has to have this feature, but it's widely present. So now if we move to the topic of this talk, the female orgasm in humans. So let's see what the empirical data tell us about orgasms in females, in human females. The first important observation is that there seems to be no correlation between either increased fitness or reproductive success and the ability to have orgasms for female humans. So what this means in plain language is simply that women who can have orgasms more easily than other women do not necessarily have more children, are more successful reproductively than the women who do not have orgasms. In fact, you can be a very successful mother of 10 or I don't know how many kids and never have an orgasm in your whole life. That's perfectly possible. There's absolutely no contradiction there. The second important empirical observation is that apparently, on the basis of empirical research that has been done by a number of scientists, and here you see Masters and Johnson, this famous couple of researchers who have done a lot of research on the sexual behavior of humans, there seems to be a very small percentage of women, females, humans, who achieve orgasm during intercourse. And this is a very important qualification. So the during intercourse qualification is very important. I do want to say that the empirical data available are conflicting and the different methodologies are used, so it's kind of difficult to compare. But still, and I think I hardly dare ask it, but I think, you know, anecdotal evidence also confirms that it's not that easy to have an orgasm while having intercourse. I don't know if the ladies in the audience would agree with me, but you don't dare manifesting yourselves at this point? Fine. But so anyway, so this is kind of widely recognized. So on the basis of these two observations, right, that the trait of having orgasms reliably during intercourse is not widely present in the population in question, and that it does not correlate with increased reproductive success. On the basis of these two observations, I think the conclusion is obvious. Female orgasm in humans is not an adaptation, right? Just like the tail of the peacock is not an adaptation for the peacock. So what is it then? If it's not an adaptation, what is the evolutionary explanation for the fact that human females are able to have orgasms? So the story in this book that I was telling you about, Elizabeth Lloyd examines, I think, 21 different evolutionary accounts of female orgasm, and she defends this one account, which she calls the bonus account, as the only one which really is confirmed by the available empirical evidence. What is the bonus account? The bonus account starts out, and this is a very important observation, is that the first observation is that orgasm in humans as a species, as a whole, is definitely an adaptation, right? So we don't talk about adaptations for the females of a species or the males of a species. We talk about adaptations for the whole species. And if you look at the whole species, there's no doubt that the capacity to have orgasms is adaptive for the species because it's adaptive for the males of the species. So that much is clear. Another important thing to keep in mind is that males and females share the same embryonic development up to 10 weeks of pregnancy, which means that the tissues and nervous connections that allow for males to have orgasms when they eventually are born and grow up, etc., etc., the same tissues and nervous connections are also present in the females, even though in slightly different shape. But they're all there too, it's really the same. So in that case, what this means is that the conclusion, the obvious conclusion to me, at least it's obvious, and in fact I have to tell you this, I came up with this idea of the bonus account all by myself one day, and I was all proud of myself and thinking, well, I'm a genius. And of course, only to go on and check on the internet and see that other people had proposed it as well. Elizabeth Lloyd herself and Stephen Jay Gould, who I'll talk about in a minute, but at least I was in good company. So that's why I have a lot of conviction on this account, because I kind of independently discovered it too in a Sunday afternoon where I was kind of bored and somehow started thinking about this. So the conclusion is that female humans have the ability to have orgasms because of the selective pressure on males to develop this trait, and which they then share because of the shared common embryonic development. So that means that female orgasm does not have a particular function to fulfill in the same way that male orgasm does. And in this sense, so this is why you can describe it as a bonus, right? So female orgasm is a bonus of the process of natural selection for male orgasm. And in this case, it's analogous to the presence of nipples in humans, in male humans. Why do males have nipples, right? They don't need them. They're not doing anything with them, or at least not anything obvious. I mean, I guess you could be creative there. But in first instance, in any case, there's no particular function. Well, males have nipples precisely because they share the same bodily architecture as the females of the species, and obviously for the females of the species, having nipples is highly advantageous because, of course, it contributes to the process of breastfeeding their babies, which is very adaptive. So it's the same story. The male nipple is a bonus, just as female orgasm is a bonus too. It doesn't have a particular function to perform. So there are some alternative accounts, many other accounts on the market, right? So I've been telling you about the bonus account, which is the one that I like best, but it actually is not very popular among biologists. These scientists, most of them don't really like the bonus account. And in a minute, I'll tell you why. So before that, let me tell you a bit about what the options are, what the other accounts are. And most of them, almost all of them, want to find a function for female orgasm. It has to be there for some reason, right? There has to be a purpose in it. And there are two kinds of such accounts according to Elizabeth Lloyd Glenn. Again, so there's the pair bond accounts, which say that pair bonding, right, male-female pair bonding is adaptive, right, has an evolutionary function to perform, and that female orgasm would enhance the pair bonding. But of course, these people, what they're really talking about when they talk about female orgasm, what they really talk about is intercourse. And they're thinking, of course, having intercourse should increase the bond between the male and the female. But what they're doing here is, of course, overlooking the orgasm-intercourse discrepancy that I just told you about. So, right? So that if, like, say, 3/4 of women do not regularly have orgasms while having intercourse, this story doesn't really work very well. The other side is actually even worse, in a sense. So the other side says that the other theories say that there must be some sort of function that female orgasm plays in the moment of fertilization. Somehow it enhances fertilization. And then there's this really fantastic hypothesis, which is known as the Upstock hypothesis. And according to this hypothesis, when a woman has an orgasm, the uterus creates a suction. And if she happens at that very time, very moment, to be having intercourse, and if the male happens to ejaculate exactly at that moment, ta-da, right? The female orgasm is going to help the sperm go towards the uterus, and therefore this will enhance fertilization. But what's the myth here? Does anyone have an idea of which myth is being presupposed here? Yes, the myth of simultaneous orgasms. It's yet another one of those crazy myths that somebody invented at some point, but it's completely, completely insane. So I mean, I just talked about these two accounts briefly. The main point is that they are not supported by the available empirical evidence. So the question is, why are these other accounts that are very poorly supported by the available empirical evidence, why have they been so popular? That is the question. They're all flawed by conflicts with the available evidence. And here's Elizabeth Lloyd here, the lady I've been talking about from the beginning. And so she asks this question, why have they been so popular? And she attributes this phenomenon to the effect of two biases, two tendencies in the work of the scientists that, rather than being beneficious for their scientific work, have led them astray, have put them in the wrong direction. And these are the two biases that she talks about. The first one is sex bias. And here's, of course, our friend Sigmund Freud, who we have already encountered in the lecture just before me. And the sex bias is the bias of approaching female sexuality as if it was identical to male sexuality. And this means, in particular, and you can't really see because I chose like a nice color, but clearly you can't really see it. But the idea is that by looking at female sexuality as if it was identical to male sexuality, what happens is that people get fixated on intercourse again, because that's, you know, the quintessential, at least according to some traditional story, because even that is contested now, but that should be the quintessential way for a male to achieve orgasm. But again, not so for women. So the problem with this bias is that then it focuses on intercourse rather than on other forms of stimulation that are more likely to produce orgasm in the females. And the other bias is the adaptationist bias. So this is a very widespread bias among evolutionary biologists. It's the bias of always preferring evolutionary explanations that focus on adaptations, that attribute a particular adaptive function to the trait. And the assumption here is that all or most traits in organisms are adaptations. And that's why what you do is like, oh, okay, here's the trait, the organism has a trait. It has to have a function somewhere. So let's reverse engineer and try to find a function for this trait. And so this, the result of this is a lot of just-so stories, very fun, you know, very creative stories on what possibly the function could be. And the main critic of this ultra-adaptationist approach in biology was Stephen Jay Gould, who sadly died much too young, about 10 years ago. And he was really, so he has, for those of you who are familiar with it, he wrote this paper called The Panglossian Paradigm and the Vaults of the Cathedral of San Marco, and where he criticizes this idea of everything has to be an adaptation at the expenses of other evolutionary processes. So these two biases, according to Elizabeth Lloyd, are the ones that are causing scientists not to see that the best account is by far the bonus account. So I had prepared a very boring conclusion, very scientific, where, you know, the way I do when I give scientific talks, and I summarize the main findings, etc., etc. But now I'm thinking, this is really boring. So instead, while listening to the previous talk, I thought, what we really need to talk about now is, what are the implications for our sex life from the fact that, let's say, if we adopt the bonus account of female orgasm? I think that's really the crucial question. Right? So the first lesson that I hope you all take home from now is intercourse is not the best way for women to achieve orgasm. I hope you all remember that, both boys and girls. But I think there's a more interesting question there. And some feminists actually got very angry when Elizabeth Lloyd wrote this book, because they thought, oh, so you're saying that my orgasm that is so important to me is useless? They were really offended by that. There were huge discussions. But then Elizabeth Lloyd replies, no, no, think about it. It's a present. It's a bonus. It's a fantastic thing that you get to enjoy as much as you want. It doesn't have to perform any function. It's just for fun. Isn't that wonderful? But apparently some feminists were not really convinced. So, I mean, that's really what I basically, rather than the boring conclusions that I have here, this is what I really want you to think about. What does it mean for us if that's really the case, that female orgasm is a bonus, doesn't have any function to play? In what way does this influence our own sex practices, our own sex lives? And, you know, I can think of many ways in which that's the case, but I'll leave it all to your creativity to think about it. Thank you.